Boomer's not going to let you hide. He wants to try and bring down a force, but a force ends the crowd. And Chemp pulls Fear back in the base after a force gets a double kill. Leap up away! The leap up! The swap on the leap!
Butchering Brax. Phase Shift dodges it. But to what end? They have done no damage. Now they're soft down, and Fnatic are going to move on here.
Both goes, they want to see another tree line. Deadly gonna phase shift, and then with Achievement's gone, they're gonna jump in. Koro! Big stun, double stun, feed your cancel black hole, won't go! He actually gets two! KYX wide up higher, locked in position, a force with a double kill, Mushi almost dead, it is dead, Mushi down, SK will fly back, and GG! Darby!
Are you ready?
And welcome back to the MLG TKO tournament, where we've got Team Empire facing up against Fnatic. I know a lot of you guys have been wondering exactly what's going on. Basically, we just finished up the Dota 2 Champions League. So if you missed out on that, it was a pretty epic series. But because of the way it went so long, basically the whole entire series took 4 hours, of course, Power Rangers, they had this sort of schedule that was going directly from D2CL into MLG. However, because of the fact that it took 2 extra hours than a normal series like that would take, Power Rangers go ahead and they couldn't make the MLG match, obviously, so we just go ahead, postpone that for another day, and we're just going to go straight into Team Empire versus Fnatic. So that will be the only series for tonight, thank God. And let's go ahead and get into it, guys, shall we? I am excited because Fnatic versus Empire, I think this should be one hell of a game. And I'm always excited to watch both of these teams, actually. I'm big fanboy of both of them. And I can go ahead, as we get our draft overlay set up, I can welcome in my co-caster for today's games is going to be Clairvoyance, who already apparently has an inside sneak peek into the Team Empire draft, or at least he thought so, until that Dazzle pickup.
Yeah, certainly. And now we see the Slaughter being banned up, so all of a sudden the famed and fabled, if you would, Empire five-man lineup with the inclusion of Apparition, Dazzle, the Doombringers, the Slaughters, and all of these other things that could be qualified as niche for the Team Empire in this current metagame, or at least over the last couple of days, is all but a foregone hope. And another thing that I had in mind, which is the lineup that was given to me by some of my friends as I was speaking to them before the game, is also something that's been toppled over. So it's unfortunate that I guess we might not get to see some of the Wisp Tiny combinations or with the Prophet as well as in conjunction with the Apparition. Still, the possibility exists, but at the same time, now with the Slaughter ban and the Dazzle pickup, things are about to become a lot more Empire than I had personally expected. And Cap, you know, you were touching upon the Power Rangers game. Of course, I'm a huge fan of Power Rangers, if anybody knows of some of the things I've been mentioning as of late. And it's unfortunate I don't get to see them versus Empire specifically this day, because I feel like they're actually two of the strongest teams coming into this current state of the game, as well as some of these matches recently. I mean, we know Empire 3-0'd Na'Vi the other day, and Power Rangers, they 2-0'd them just yesterday. And of course, they fell before Cloud9, but Cloud9, certainly known for their prowess as well. So, not to take away credit from anything, of course, I want to give major shout-outs to Bone7 for playing absolutely phenomenal in that last series there. But right now, different story, different teams. Storm Spirit being the pickup for Team Empire, and looks like they want to go for that global presence slash initiation again, whereas Fnatic going for the traditional pickups with the Lifestealer and Puck, something that I personally haven't seen too much. Of course, Bone7 just played it about 30 minutes ago or so. Looks like we'll get to see a demonstration again this game.
Yeah, which means that we either are getting very, very greedy for Fnatic, and we're seeing Doom as a pure jungler, and the other three are all cores in lane, and we're only going to see one support, or that means we're going to see a Mirana support without already seeing a support to be able to set it up. Normally, it's the Bane. That would be the good Mirana support remaining. Bane combo. I actually had a couple games this morning in the Chinese scene, it being run on both sides of the series, actually. It was very, very entertaining to watch. Mirana support actually is able to do a lot of work, and it's something that I haven't seen in quite some time.
Certainly. And I personally wouldn't rule it out to be anything. Of course, the hero is known for her versatility in the Priestess, and with the Doombringer being the first pickup, it can be a little bit ambiguous in terms of exactly what lanes who will go where. But the other side of the story, or flip the coin and you'll see Empire, they're not exactly hiding cards. We know that the Apparition as well as Dazzle are probably going to be supports. Of course, we've seen the Dazzle cores being played a couple times here and there. I think EG ran it at one point as well. To success, I might add, but at the same time, the hero does have its limitations, and there are reasons why certain core heroes are available to be supports and perhaps even better supports than they are cores. So I feel like Dazzle just fits that category of being a fantastic support, so long as he can find the early levels. And I really feel like with the Storm Spirit as well as the Luna, they have the room and the potential to put out a lot of mid-game pressure and aggression with regards to just sustainability as well as taking engagements when the opposition is not necessarily prepared. And I feel like Nature's Prophet would have added to that so handily well. But at the same time, Fnatic realizes the same thing and says, nope, you're not going to get the Prophet. You're not going to add him to the global presence with that three-position hero you're missing.
Yeah, that would have been the perfect addition to Team Empire. And I love how teams are really experimenting with running global strategies with Ancient Apparition. We're seeing the rise of Spectre, big ganking heroes like Nyx Assassin, Storm Spirit, even other heroes like Puck are even being run that are able to set up really, really well. And just the basic amount of burst damage that you need, and then add in a little bit extra on Ice Blast, and it just kind of is the tipping point for a lot of mid-game fights. So I love to see how Ancient Apparition is just kind of went from a never-picked-up support to already seeing as first, second pick for a lot of teams. Now, Batrider going to be picked up. There's another ganking hero that's going to be able to do well with the Ancient Apparition. But Fnatic have gone full-on greed here with the Sand King being their last pickup. I can't believe this. This is something that we pretty much have five different heroes who are all non-4 or 5s. Like, Sand King is oftentimes a 4 support, but he's very, very greedy in regards that he really wants Blink Dagger. He really wants a lot of other things. And so Fnatic here, is this still going to be Mirana support, Sand King as leading your stun here with a Sand King for Burst Strike? Like, I've always said you need a setup stun for Sand King, not the other way around. Like, Sand King isn't really supposed to be initiating stun early on because that level 1 range is just so short. Even level 2 is not the greatest on Burrow Strike. So, yeah, I think they're going to have a hard time setting up their kills here with the stun into the Burrow Strike into the arrow combo. But they do have an overwhelming amount of mid to late game, and Team Empire don't necessarily have ways to be able to really punish this greedy support pickup.
Oh yeah, certainly in terms of the early games, I feel like Fnatic's pickup is actually pretty fantastic, because I was thinking maybe the Earthshaker would work better with the lineup that they have set up for them. I mean, you were talking about the long range initiations, and Priestess just happens to have a linear skill shot that likes to follow up to the Earthshaker, as well as a couple other things. Earthshaker just providing support from being hidden off the map because he has that range. Sand King, of course, has to get a lot closer, and he doesn't necessarily have the gap closer per se, aside from the Burrow Strike as well as the imminent Blink Dagger. But I mean, in terms of scaling, you're right. It's very superior in many senses, but at the same time, I wouldn't really rule out Empire's ability to fight that. And I'm going to have to hold that thought, because Empire is looking to get very aggressive from the early stages already. And I really do feel like Empire's heroes, once again, Dazzle is a support hero that scales very well. Ancient Apparition, getting the note of getting picked up so early, because he does scale as one of the best right now in this current metagame anyway. And Batrider always has that ability to make that team fight similar to a Doom, make it 4v5, or take the fight when you don't want to, and just completely shut out a hero's existence and its presence for a short duration of time, unless the target gets bursted, in which case it does its job correctly. So I feel like both lineups are pretty well crafted right now, and we're just going to have to see how the lanes pan out here.
As the horn blows, I do want to talk about one thing. Is in this tri-lane scenario here, I didn't actually think Empire were going to be able to actually punish Fnatic for their greedy supports, because I see Dazzle and I automatically think, oh, that's going to be a defensive tri-lane. But here they are running aggressive, and I forgot about the power of it, just any tri-lane. With the Luna, Ancient Apparition, that's just a lot of auto-attacking power. And Dazzle does give you some survivability here, so this is pretty decent, but do you think that they can contest, can Fnatic actually stand up against that, or we're already seeing smoke up in early rotation? Do Fnatic just completely dodge it, leave Era alone in this lane, and just try and make as many rotations into the solo lanes as possible?
Oh, absolutely. You know, at this point, looking at the draft right now, Cap, Fnatic can put 4 heroes against that tri lane and they would still lose. That's how powerful that tri lane coming out of Empire is. There is just way too much aggression coming from the lower levels in that Chilling Touch as well as the right clicks. And as you said, Dazzle always just provides that boon with regards to keeping people alive and having that lane sustain in whatever spell he skills. If he gets the slow with the Poison Touch at level 1, that's been buffed up. I'm going to hold that thought, because Resolution possibly getting initiated on here.
Yep, he finally does get in range of the Burrow Strike, throws it up line, and is able to land it. Resolution in some trouble, now going to turn, and the beautiful Vanskor coming in to ensure first blood. Resolution may still go down here, but actually potion up, and Hani can't even pursue. Now always want to fly, countering him. One orb jaunt away, and he gets it. Hani able to get out, but still great first blood turnaround with Dazzle making the big difference, picking up his Shallow Grave at level 1 and teleporting in. Beautiful play, Vanskor. The important thing there, holding off on his skill build until it's necessary for him to pick something up. So many times you would see, I mean, a minute into a lane, you would normally pick up something like a Poison Touch or even the heal by now, but him holding on to it and then leveling Shallow Grave as he sees the need for it in middle was perfect timing for them to turn around and pick up first blood.
Absolutely. And a phenomenal return coming out of Empire. The response from the support, as you mentioned, with the skilling of the spell, the Shallow Grave, everything just flawless, and Resolution demonstrating his high skill once again, saying that I'm not fazed by the low HP that I have. I can trust in my support, rely on my right clicks to secure the deal, and your heroes are not necessarily the best when it comes to early lane, early game aggression. So now Resolution back into the mid lane. He's full, whereas Hani is slowly regening up, but he does have that extra set of tangles in his inventory. So looks like both heroes will be fine, but Empire always want to fly, standing by at the mid lane here. Doesn't seem like Resolution really needs the buff up with the cold, chilling touch right now. But if it comes to pass where he does, then he can LCS Hani very easily with the addition of the chilling touch.
Right now, we are focusing a lot on this tri-lane versus tri-lane scenario and the rotations mid. But I do want to take just a quick moment to look at top, where Mag is currently leading CS 11-2, 12-3. Trixie actually getting ahead just now. But very, very tight neck at top, and you've got a lot of creeps coming in for Batrider to eat up. So he's doing well at top lane. Middle going fantastic because of the first blood going the way of Resolution, thanks to the Dazzle save. And the aggressive tri lane turned out very, very well. Top three CS on the board all going the way of Empire. Trixie just kind of hovering back and forth as time goes on. He's being able to contest that, but the other two lanes, not nearly as much. Fnatic need to turn something around. Burrow Strike, where's the arrow? Going to be coming in from the side, but Silent has the perfect movement to be able to dodge it. Now, still churning a little bit. Fly going to get low, but Silent cannot pursue here, as it's just the dual lane, able to deal with a Burrow Strike arrow combo and come out without losing a hero like that. Goes to show just kind of their lane domination, being able to pick up these early levels. This is perfect. Dazzle is ensuring that Luna can get decently aggressive, farm up, and they can have Always Want to Fly move elsewhere. Though I'm not entirely sure where Always Want to Fly is going right now. He's not a hero that really rotates around the map well, and if they had him there, maybe that actually would have been a kill for Empire.
I think what he's looking to do, yeah, he's just looking to stack up for Mag. I did want to touch upon on this right here. The top lane matchup, Doom against Batrider, with all the Batrider changes and tweaks and possibly nerfs, you would call it. I think the Doom has the favor in this matchup, especially an experienced offlane player like Trixie can probably take advantage of this very well. He also has that Ward Stomp, just in case the Batrider decides to be the aggressor and tries to engage on him, he can just stomp and get out with the Scorched Earth, boosted movement speed. But I think the gameplay of Batrider as a whole kind of changed. Before, Batrider really needed to have a good start, and not necessarily because he can always catch up and make that difference X-Factor kind of play with his lasso as well as Blink. But nowadays, Batrider, they're content with letting the opposition in the lane farm up just as well as they are. Because at the end of the day, you're never really going to stop a Batrider from farming his lane. And of course, if you have something like this where all he's going to fly is committing his entire time to stack up the jungle for the future case of the Batrider, then they're both securing themselves a nice lead into the game. So it's all in all, everything is going well. Now, Hani's rotated to the top, but he doesn't have Coil, and that's going to be a crucial factor here.
Yep,
he decides to back.
It could have all gone back to, again, the save from Dazzle. If they'd killed Resolution, Puck might be level 6, and then he would actually be able to use Coil offensively against Mag, hold him in place, Doom being able to provide that follow-up. It's interesting how those things can kind of snowball, especially if they overextend here. Doom is going to go down on Mag, but he just simply goes off the map, and unless they hit both the orb and the silence, it does.
Oh, honey.
Oh, no, he's completely overextended himself, though. That commitment, I think he knew he needed to have the damage in order to have a chance to kill Mag, but now puts himself pretty deep out there. Trixie trying to chase away the two heroes to make sure that Hani does get out, but a haste rune and a lot of time completely wasted. And Trixie is actually going to go down here. So rotations come in. Resolution easily going to be able to provide enough damage to hold Trixie in place. With all of that slow from Sticky Napalm, you just really cannot overextend yourself against a Batrider like that, because you will get punished if the Batrider does survive.
Yeah, quite honestly, I mean, with the orb, Hani should have had the flying vision necessary to see the bat even if he's off the map. Batrider was sitting at like 600 HP, 600 life points after the Doom had already invested two-thirds of the Doom timer ticking away. So at best, the Batrider would have gone down to like 500-400 HP at best. And honestly, Hani just committing that far, like I really thought Mag was just going to turn on him for a second there, because a puck at this stage in the game is really, really squishy and really easy to deal with. And as I say that, Luna picks up a kill on the Sand King rotating in a no-tail with 5 clarities at the start of the game and 5 clarities at 6 minutes and 30 into the game. Looks like his ganks are not being successful.
Yeah, he hasn't really fired. The couple arrows that they have gone for and have landed haven't really turned out that much. Surprisingly enough, Sand King not able to... Like, I thought that if they were able to hit the Burrow Strike, sure, you get a kill. But my biggest issue was, are you ever actually going to get in close range to be able to land that Burrow Strike? Sand King does a little bit more damage than Earthshaker at this point in time. You're able to actually get in melee range and start providing some auto attacks that combo well with the additional Son of Imrana arrow. I really thought they were going to be able to pick off a lot of heroes if they were able to get the Burrow Strike. And they have successfully quite a number of times here, and yet they still have not been able to get a kill as that dual core, just because of the fact that oftentimes Dazzle has been the interrupting factor. Being able to provide that heal, that Shallow Grave, has been a big turnaround for them. Now they're going to have Always Want to Fly like this play, though. Empire, having Always Want to Fly in this top lane, farming up, trying to get level 6. Bottom, though, we do have Arrow, who's going to get very, very low here. Resolution dodges the Burrow Strike, but can't continue to go forward. Arrow's going to fly out, but completely misses. Hani does have a coil if he wants to try and set this up, but Empire completely full health here. Fly going to cop a little bit of damage here, has a Burrow Strike in just another second, so Resolution should be a little bit careful here. Meanwhile, top, we do have Trixie, who should be able to finish off Always Want to Fly easily. Back at bottom, just making sure that... There it is, Trixie actually... Resolution jumps in. They hit the arrow. Resolution getting very, very low. Shallow Grave holding him alive for just a second. Doom finally does finish off that Ancient Apparition, but Silent, he's the one in real trouble right now. If they pick off this carry beautifully, they grab him. Now Vanskor trying to teleport away, and no stuns available. Just one more hit, and they would have got it. But they keep the Storm Spirit alive, but they lose Luna in exchange. I can't believe Empire still stuck around, especially seeing Era just kind of sitting there, Fly sitting there in his Sandstorm, like he was going to have a Burrow Strike up eventually. I can't believe they still tried to force that, even though they came away from the initial fight away just fine.
Mm-hmm. It is certainly a surprising thing to see Empire showing so many great plays as of late, overcommitting themselves in that kind of a scenario and getting themselves conclaved in between the enemy forces in that manner. And of course, Always Want to Fly, seasoned Apparition player and seasoned support player now as well, getting caught off guard. I don't really want to say off guard, because I felt like he kind of probably had an idea that the Doom was going to see an opportunity to go for a solo kill. Apparition doesn't really have any spells to disengage as much as he has AoE ranged nukes from a distance with the Ice Blast, as well as aerial support coming out from his other support spells. But yeah, getting solo killed up there, giving Trixie an extra surge of gold, not necessarily the best idea, and certainly got the short end of the stick on the side of Empire, but by no means is it really like putting them on their back foot for the rest of the game, because they're still at a fine state. Empire Resolution is still doing really, really well at the mid lane. And yeah, he's going to evade another gank attempt.
Okay, now looking at this Fnatic, Hani is doing pretty poorly. It's about to get worse. It's now the leash, and top of that Resolution provides the extra bit of control, and they should be able to pop him as he comes back into the fire and just burns away. So Batrider picks up that kill. But going back to it, I mean, in fact, that even ensures my point. Hani in trouble, doesn't have a Blink Dagger, won't have a Blink Dagger anytime soon. Where's the next bomb going to come from? You can't really rely on Orb necessarily as being your initiating factor. So does Trixie get a Blink Dagger after his Vanguard, which it looks like he's grabbing?
Quite possibly. Now, of course, Always Want to Fly might not want to go for a round two facing up against the core hero alone. The good thing now is that this might turn out to be a bait if Resolution decides to go rotate to the bottom lane, but instead he's actually going to rotate to mid for a possible TP rotation, and they're going to try to just shut down Hani even further, which is, once again, it's the alright thing to do, but he has the Haste Rune and could have probably made more out of it, especially against a hero like Lifestealer. Of course, he has the Rage, but if they time it correctly, Ancient Apparition and Storm Spirit is a thing of the past that used to be a wombo combo. certainly very, very powerful. And rotation to the top lane now.
Oh no, Tail just got himself stuck in the trees, but we'll see if it plays out for him. Fly, gonna get caught out here. Burrow Strike not gonna be up in time. The ultimate being thrown down by Silent, and no, Tail stuck in the trees. That isn't, you are not a jungle cat. You can't climb up trees, sir. Trixie's gonna get caught out as well, as the slow from Sticky Napalm will hold him in place long enough for them to get the kill. So three heroes go down, all in exchange for a Dazzle. Not a bad exchange whatsoever for Team Empire. Their rotations, they're doing well right now. And this is exactly the kind of moment where you would love to see a little bit stronger supports up from Fnatic that do a little bit more pre-level 6. Top, though, more fights. Silent getting low, but Shallow Grave saves them once again, and Hani will fall. They were all in a position to be able to pick off one hero. Now Mag catches an arrow to the face, but they should be fine with no open wounds up on Era. Can't possibly pursue that. On top of that, a lot of heroes maybe going to go for more here. Batrider grabs and pulls them back into the Ice Blast. Now burning away Era with the nuke coming out from the Luna. Ensures the kill. So three kills, turn to four, turn to five. Fnatic are just falling apart right now.
Right, right. And Cap, I don't mean to take away from Empire right now. They're of course playing amazing Dota at this point. But I feel like Fnatic are just really overextending themselves in a lot of these situations. A lot of these kills, I just normally wouldn't characterize Fnatic giving up. And of course, some of the instances, like for example at mid lane with Hani as well as the first blood attempt, I want to say part of it should be expected, but it's somewhat unprecedented as well. For example, you wouldn't expect such good support rotations, and sometimes you feel like you have the power to kill, and then if it turns out you don't, you can just back out safely with heroes like Lifestealer. But against Empire's lineup, that is not the case. Once again, they have an extreme long range of reach that they can accomplish with just a click of a Blink Dagger or with the Storm Spirit Ultimate. And they have to always be aware of the overarching presence of the Ancient Apparition on the map. So Fnatic getting caught out like this in this manner, and as you said, with supports that are not very good pre-6, who are actually still at the pre-6 stage, and as I say that, I'm looking at Fly, he's level 7, so Fly is in a better state, almost got his Blink Dagger as well, but No Tail still struggling to find farms, still struggling to find levels, and I don't know, things are just not going the best for them right now.
Yeah, and this means that Empire can get pretty aggressive, I feel, before the Blink Dagger is going to be up in time, but before Mirana is actually able to get out those maxed out nukes and that sort of thing. Lifestealer, despite the fact that he's been able to pick up some farm, is still not going to be that effective because Dazzle is actually a pretty decent counter to him. He has a slow, he has Shell Grave, which is excellent against any sort of single target, and the physical damage coming out from heal as well as the minus armor, both excellent versus a Lifestealer. So this support Dazzle will be able to counter Well, as I say that, they actually just pick up the Ancient Apparition. Looks like an arrow was able to land, but still, I feel that Empire have the mobility, the damage to really be able to group up and use this Luna aura. They don't have the traditional pushing squad up behind a Luna, but I think that with the way this laning phase went for them, they could easily push pretty heavily, in the 15 to 25 minute mark before Fnatic get up their full mid game. Considering how lackluster their laning phase was, it's going to be delayed quite a bit.
Oh yeah, it certainly will. And of course, it would be a nice move to keep trying to delay it. But at what cost is what I have to ask at this point? Because every time Fnatic has rotated to try and delay that, or delay the opposition from actually delaying them even further. So I guess to simplify it, you can say for them to actually get an advantage. I'm going to hold that thought at top lane.
Yep, easy combo. They just jump in, grab them, pull back. The Ice Blast wasn't even needed as Luna was fortunate to get every single one of those eclipses on the Doom, but that was a great pickoff. Like, Doom is pretty much your most farmed hero right now for Fnatic, so taking him down a notch is going to be able to ensure that he won't be able to get that second item, whether it's just more tank or whether he actually goes for initiation and goes for a Blink Dagger.
Right, right. And as we see, oh, hold that thought once again, big arrow landing on Silent, and there's a rotation of TP coming out from Hani.
They're going to go for this. Hani does have a coil ready up and hits two with it. Now trying to dodge a bit of that damage. Fly comes in and out the Infest Bomb. Going to go on Luna, but nice. Shell Grave holds him up just alive for a little bit longer. This is delayed damage. Era still beating him. Finally will go down. Now Doom comes back into play. Era will miss as Mag tries to pursue out the Lifestealer. Not going to be able to get him. Doom going to be able to finish off the Ancient Apparition. Meanwhile, Mag actually does kill the Mirana. Back at the Doom, though. Being able to fight up Vanskorr should be able to pick him up. Storm Spirit able to grab the Lifestealer from behind. And now they're going to collide on Trixie. All they have to do is kite him around long enough for Resolution to come in and provide that cleanup. Trixie's tanky, but there's no way for him to get away from these slows. That means he will go down. Arrow barely missing out on Mag there. As No Tail wants to be able to find him, does have Star Storm and gets him. Just has enough vision to be able to lock him down. And now Fly finds Vanskorr, Couple auto attacks will be able to get it, but they're going to overextend themselves if they go for it. Fly trying to back away. Ice Blast will land and clean them up now. And that means No Tail and Fly pay for their aggression there. No Tail did get the kill on the Batrider, and that's good for him, so I suppose that's a decent trade. But trying to go on the Dazzle there, getting a little bit greedy after what was a pretty poor team fight for them, and they definitely pay for it.
Mm-hmm. Now, I want to point out that with all the action that's been going on and how Resolution has been involved in so many of Empire's aggressions, I feel like he was kind of a little bit late to the party this time. Came in from the back and secured the kill on the Lifestealer, as well as eventually picked off the Doom and prevented Doom from putting out further aggression on his team and possibly getting kills. But speaking of kills, Hani at the mid lane, he's not exactly safe right now. And the Storm Spirit, conjunction with the ultimate, guaranteed kill.
Yeah, you use an orb like that, I mean, they would have killed him anyway, but when the orb is thrown out to try and farm, things get even worse for you. Even if he did survive through that combo or is able to dodge the Ice Blast or something like that, he still had no escape mechanism. That means Hani, still, Blink Dagger, 1,900 gold away. Like, is 17 minutes in, nowhere near a Blink Dagger like this. This is just awful. Now, it's made up by the fact that they do have other Blink Dagger initiating heroes. Fly, I completely forgot about his farm, just kind of assuming that he wasn't going to have it. When I was talking earlier about the Blink Dagger Doom, but Fly has actually been the carrier for this Nakes Bomb 90% of the time. So he's actually been a pretty big initiating factor, and I think he's the only reason Fnatic have a hope at being able to win any team fights. But right now, let's take a look at that gold lead. 5,000 gold lead right now for Empire. They have the top three net worth on the board, and 7,500 experience going the way of Empire right now.
Mm-hmm. And I think experience is pretty much the bigger telling of the tale. Of course, speaking of experience, the oddity here is that Fly, who was level 7 when No Tail is 5, is now level 8, only one level up, whereas No Tail doubled his levels up, and now he's level 10 instead of level 5. So it just goes to show that kills are so important this game, and that's where the majority of the EXP comes from for both teams. And speaking of kills...
Yep, Silent's gonna fall, Shallow Grave, no! No Tail! Beautiful play! Turns, and instead of just focusing on the Luna, turns and throws down the arrow to make sure the Shallow Grave is not in time to be able to save Luna. And that would have been big because he did have a level 2 Eclipse. They could have turned and have potentially picked up a number of kills, especially seeing how low those supports were after the Ice Blast came in.
Yeah, not too much to add to that, Cap. That's pretty much the prime definition of what you would call shut down. No Tail just shut them down pretty hard with that engagement, and of course, as a whole, Fnatic did a really nice move in team effort. At the same time, Empire is not really losing out too much aside from the two heroes, and of course, that's big in its own. But they are getting the rebuttal, which is the tower at the bottom lane. And of course, Resolution has completed himself his Orchid, whereas Hani, still 1k gold off from his Blink Dagger. We can see that right now that there's a huge disparity with regards to game impact and involvement between the two mid laners. And I think a lot of that has to come down to the pre-6 engagements, as you had called it earlier, especially with that first blood attempt.
Yep, everything could have snowballed so much better for Hani, but as it is, he's still another 1,000 gold away. We're going to have a BKB up on Mag, and that's actually pretty big because this means that when Mag jumps in, there's nothing to stop him from continuing. Not only is we're not going to see the Puck being able to throw down Dream Coil, but any sort of other responses such as Sand King, Open Moon.
Oh, solo kill, solo kill on Hani.
Oh, Hani going to get cleaned up by the Orchid. I saw them rotating in, but Resolution with that big jump, able to catch him out. Nice agility treads as well, and they're going to go right back to doing Roshan.
And report Batrider, please. Wow, I'm not sure if he should be
on
chatting.
He has been KSing a lot. Let's be fair. How many times has that fire been on the ground when Hani was at no health, and he comes back and just lands into the fire and ends up taking the kill?
Well, I just feel like Fnatic or Hani as a whole this game would not appreciate a comment like that. But I think the more important thing here right now is that the picking the Puck into the Storm Spirit. I think there is somewhat of a misconception. Like, Puck does have a kit that can counter up the Storm Spirit, especially before level 6, because a Puck in the lane can play extremely aggressive. But after that, one of the things that Storm actually excels in is with that Orchid, he owns up a Puck completely, because you'll never see a Puck by a BKB. And most of their survivability often lies on their skill set with the Illusory Orb, as well as the timing and the reaction on the phase shift. So when you see an instant click spell, or a silence rather, coming in the Orchid, as well as a Storm Spirit comboing people up like what he's doing to Fly right now, there's not much you can do to stop it.
Yep, Trixie, though, he does have a Blink Dagger. He's going to respond in kind, though. Jumping on Resolution, throwing down that Doom. He needs to be able to get these auto attacks off. Halfway through, Storm Spear does have an Aegis and looks like he's going to burn that one. And maybe, if they can time this right, they should be able to get that instant stun, or at least the silence. Hani moving forward. Silence. Oh, there it is. Perfect. Man. Nicely done.
Couldn't have been any better on that instance, man. That was right on. Right in the middle of the arrow, very reminiscent of that Naga Siren as well as Priestess combination. Looks like these players, they just got the timings down, but once again, Empire not really losing out as a whole in terms of the exchange. They're actually going in.
No Tail being dragged back, trying to get him over the cliff, but not going to be enough. Meanwhile, the tower in deny range gets it. Life stealing nicely done, but Fly jumps in, now going on Always Want to Fly, who's trying to back up Shallow Grave and the teleport away. Smart rotation, and now they're jumping away. Hani hits a big coil here, but the question is, can they go for it? Trixie with a huge Centaur stun, locks in two, now Fly and go for more. Epicenter doing some serious work. Fly actually doing a lot of work with that Epicenter, doesn't quite finish off the Dazzle, but they do get the Ancient Apparition. Three heroes go down, and Fnatic finally get the big initiation that they need, all thanks to, we've been beating up on Hani all day, or rather, just commenting on his lack of farm and lack of impact in the game, but that four-man coil was enough to be able to allow Fly and Trixie to be able to follow up and pick off those very, very important kills for Fnatic.
Oh, absolutely. For a player who's been struggling and playing without a Blink Dagger on pretty much the core hero that defines the Blink Dagger, He actually just made one of the biggest plays with that Dream Coil. Just shutting them down and keeping them in place, allowing Fly to actually channel the full length Epicenter on top of them and come back with a massive burst damage coming up with the Brawl Strike as well. And sealed the deal there. Just a really, really big play, and once again, a fantastic rebuttal on the side of Fnatic. Now the problem is, once again, because of all the disadvantages that they've accumulated, they're going to need a couple more of those. And I really, really wish that they had pushed the issue and tried to take the mid tower after that, because that mid tower would have been huge when it comes to map control, as well as the extra burst in gold that they're really, really looking for right now.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, not only does that's a really good point, actually. That tier one tower with a Storm Spirit, any outer tower is very, very important, gives you a large jump in mobility. Hold on. Trixie does have Doom. They're going to be able to find out. Nice Burrow Strike. Fly with the perfect stun is actually going to be able to hold that mag. Resolution now turning. Doom is on cooldown, so he's going to try and finish off a support hero. No Tail will take out to the Orchid, but he doesn't have enough mana to get over the cliff. Now being held back. Three heroes down. Hani going to go for more. Always Want to Fly tries to teleport away, but there's no way. The burst damage just proven to be too much, and somehow Fnatic have turned what was a monster lead for Empire into so much more. A couple of good team fights, and now taking away some of that map control away from Team Empire.
Yeah, Cap, just as mentioned previously, they needed a couple of more of those, and boy, did they give themselves a couple more of those. That stun initiation from Fly. We talked about how the Batrider, and as well as heroes like Doombringer, these heroes can cancel out the presence of one of the heroes on the opposing side, more or less, oftentimes, and create a 4v5 situation. That Impale, or pardon me, Burrow Strike, coming out of Fly, an unprecedented stun and an initiation to no rivals and levels of the paramount moves. Oh my gosh, that was just perfect. I'm not even sure if that was calculated, honestly, because Mag blinked in thinking that he would do something similar, and Fly just came in and shut him down to his core. That was chilling. That took over the entire fight from there. Resolution no longer had the mana to escape, and of course the Ancient Apparition Blast this time. Perhaps he was too far away, but this time it was a little too late.
Yep, that was either some extreme foresight from Fly, or he was just really, really lucky on that timing, blinking in and Burrow Striking the exact same time as Mag. But either way, it was a smart move by Fly. And Silent, Team Empire trying to get a little bit of recovery here. They did have an Ancient stack that was going on earlier from the Helm of Dawn pickup on Luna. So they get not only the BKB, but get a large share of levels off of that Ancient stack, and they're still looking good. I mean, you had such a huge lead for Empire. It is still, after two really bad team fights and losing a tower, there's still 4,000 gold ahead and 4,000 experience ahead. So despite the fact that Fnatic, you know, it's just surprising. Oh man, Resolution. Can you talk about overkill? Burrow Strike, arrow, ever being thrown at the book. Now Empire gonna go for this. BKB, Luna pops the ultimate, and this is gonna tear Fnatic up. Oh, Mag with a beautiful play, stopping the Epicenter, and this team fight's over. Trixie gonna fall. Now Fly trying to get away from these two supports, but even he's gonna go down. What a beautiful play by Mag, stopping that Epicenter with a flame break. What a player.
The awareness that these guys have in high tense situations is simply phenomenal. Like Empire as a whole, we've seen them grow over time through the changing of many teams, many rosters. We know of the names of Resolution and Mega, and I'm sure they're household Dota names when it comes to the CIS scene. But these kind of high skill demonstrations as of late by Empire and Power Rangers and teams alike, I am just amazed at some of the things that these guys do. And granted, it might not seem like that big of a deal, but when you're a bad writer who's initiating for your entire team, have to pop the BKB, have to look out for all the targets, try to sticky napalm up everybody, and possibly even tank up the majority of the damage by soaking up some of the magical burst that's coming out of Fnatic. And you do that, canceling the biggest ultimate that could have been the biggest factor in that team fight as a whole if it came to pass. Yeah, you're playing MVP style of Dota right now. And what can I say, man? That was just big plays after another. One by one, these teams both just demonstrating high caliber plays left and right.
Yeah, that was just absolutely wonderful. Mac is now level 17 with the BKB. Now, it is something to note that Fly had the opportunity to turn around if he got a good epicenter, but the cores of Empire not really going to be threatened. In that team fight, both Batrider and Luna had already popped their BKBs, but now we add Storm Spirit into the mix. He's going to have a BKB as well. They are going to have to initiate with that epicenter and not just have it be a mid-team fight one, because these BKBs are all coming up for the cores of Team Empire, and that leaves just the supports who, well, Vanscore is a good pickoff because he comes into a team fight later by being able to provide a good Shallow Grave is probably his biggest role right now. So popping him early on a team fight is going to be great, but Ancient Apparition most of the time will have already thrown an Ice Blast. So I think Fnatic here, they have to be the ones, they have to get up some really good vision. They have to be the ones controlling these team fights and initiating these team fights and being able to stun lock down these heroes, because if Empire see what's happening, if they see the initiation coming, Fnatic are just going to get wrecked. All of their magic damage is going to be destroyed by preemptive popped BKBs.
Mm-hmm. Oh, certainly. Definitely don't want to rule out the repelling of the magical burst coming out of the Black King bars. It's just with the epicenter, once again, I don't want to overemphasize it, of course. The fight did seem like it was Empire's to take. But at the same time, the epicenter slow, as well as the other things such as the magical burst follow-ups, and being able to survive the duration of the burst, it's just a really big deal. But I'm going to hold that thought, because another big engagement I just linked.
Oh, Meg! Fast BKB, and now they're turning around. Empire popping both the dirt BKBs. Trixie lost in the middle of Sea of Heroes. Hani going to get bursted down. Era has to pop out here, pop the Rage, and teleport away, and he will get out. Meanwhile, back over there, No Tail being held in by the Lasso. Mag with supreme reactions thanks to a counter ward that was actually in this area for Empire. They saw it for just a half a second, and Mag had a beautiful blink away and then turned around with the BKB. Again, Fnatic, they knew what needed to be done, which was they had to have the initiation. So they smoke up, Moonlight Shadow move out, but they didn't find it. Empire able to see it just a second before it actually occurred, and that made all the difference with mass BKBs coming out.
Right, and mass BKBs for sure is the name of the game. That reaction, just as you called it, man, spotless, right on. I've never seen such a fast sequence of button smashing in the right sequence. Like, he blinked in, and I presume that was a misblink of sorts, or he just blinked in to, I guess, get the last hit on some of the ancients going down. But as I say that, I'm going to have to hold that thought, because Resolution is hot on Pursuit, and Fly is looking pretty good right now.
All right, he's going to be fine. He clicked on Resolution, was like, oh, you got no mana whatsoever. All right, I'll just go ahead and walk away from this team fight. But yeah, man, Mag now has a gem on top of the four staff blink and BKB that he already had, and now has a Boots of Travel on top of that. I was like, that's looking a little light for items for Mag, honestly, considering the way he's playing, which is just goddamn out of this goddamn world. I expect more. Boots of Travel is now his next pickup. Maybe we'll even see that famed Mask of Madness pickup for Batrider as well.
Oh dear. Yep. And Bone 7 starts ringing the phone, and here comes Mag coming with max movement speed, kidnapping people left and right. But I agree with your thoughts, of course. Mag is just playing absolutely amazing this game. And I think for Batrider as a whole, I want to put it into the words and quote my friend Liquid Bulba here. That hero as a whole, it's just one of those heroes that for every 2,000 gold you accumulate on the hero changes. The first is usually on the Blink Dagger, the second is on the Four Staff, and all of a sudden the third with the Boots of Travel most of the time, and I know it was a different sequence this time, they opted for the BKB prior to, but it just goes to demonstrate that the hero's potential becomes that much greater, because his synergy with mobility items, and granted, he's already extremely mobile without those items per se, it just jumps off the roof. It skyrockets, and there is nothing that compares to it. So he's hot on the prowl once again, but with those items in his inventory, he's feeling relatively safe on that regard as well.
Yeah, that Boots of Travel is going to do wonders with the already kind of global strat that they've got going on with Storm Spirit and the Ancient Apparition. Storm Spirit, kind of pseudo-global with his high amount of mobility. Always want to fly. That is a five-second arrow, but right now we do have two heroes pushing in top, and they're not willing to take the fight at the tier two. Waiting until Empire try and push uphill, and that's exactly what they're going to do. Going uphill, Hani going to get caught out by the Orkin and bursted down. Arrow pops out, trying to do what damage he can, but Fly already coming in is going to have to back up and try and reinitiate with the Epicenter. Trixie fighting up against his Vanguard is doing a decent amount, and Moonlight Shadow going out. No dust coming away from Empire, and because of this, they may have to back out. They're already doing a lot of damage this tier three, but I don't like the chances of Fnatic being able to reset up their initiation onto Empire, who are already kind of low. Now they're going to back up, heal up, and I like this move actually. They get themselves out, but the weave, yes, exactly. That ultimate's going to come into play.
Yeah, that ultimate is actually really huge, especially for these high ground siege scenarios. Hold that thought, Burrow Strike going down, and of course that was for Fly to evade, but the engagement looks like it's almost not done. Arrow connects.
Gets away from the Centaur, Orchid up on No-Tail, he's gonna burst it down, Ice Blast is gonna be decent, but there goes that Epicenter! Four heroes locked in, close Congress with Fly doing a lot of damage here. Era coming back in, but can't seem to finish off any of these heroes, jumps inside, Fly trying to get him out, Burrow Strike, not gonna be in time, and now Era left out in the cold, gonna be able to get back to his fountain. Hani comes back into play, but unable to finish off any hero, just the Dazzle goes down. Mag trying to chase him, meanwhile back at that team fight, double Burrow Strike coming out from Fly, but there's no real follow-up. Mag chasing him down, Fly gonna go down, and this looks like the end of the team fight. Empire gonna be able to control the base and go for a second set of racks. Era desperately moving forward to try and kill anybody, but all of Empire too high up. And he just can't simply do enough damage. Ice Blast. Oh, Era. Nice little dodge there. That was a beautiful play, being able to get away from the Ice Blast on just the edges of the fountain. But Empire, they get themselves the racks. They do back off, unfortunately, because Tier 2's being up on both sides, both of the side lanes. They can't immediately go for another Tier 3. But they can just back up, control the map, and wait for the next Roshan before they push in once again.
Oh, absolutely. And with the mid-Raxxes going down in their favor, there's going to be an ample number of opportunities that will arise for them. And honestly, this team, as we've seen so far, have demonstrated that even if they don't see a window, they will create one. Like, if you saw how that engagement just began as a whole, if you recall inside the base, how far Resolution actually dove in, mm-hmm. along with the rest of Empire's heroes just trotting their way in by walking because they don't have the mobility engagement like the Storm Spirit does. And they went so deep into the enemy territory that the enemy is actually so frightened they have to use all of their spells to hold their ground as well. And it's the level of aggression that I normally don't see from many heroes except like some of the CIS teams. And I think Na'Vi put out a similar level of aggression. But honestly, that kind of dive into the base, it's always risky no matter how far you're ahead. And Empire just demonstrating that they're very, very confident as Hani gets solo killed by the Storm once again.
Yep, Haste Rune, and that Orchid makes it for easy pickoff, and now they got another one. This one's big. Fly gonna get caught out, Moonlight Shadow won't save him. Era's gonna hold up silent for a second here, but that's it. They caught out two of the most important initiating heroes, and Fnatic gonna tap out of this two-game series. Game one does go the way of Empire as they clean up some additional heroes, but really well done. That was such a fun match, back and forth. And even though Fnatic started out very, very far behind, they managed to claw their way back into the game, somehow being able to have a bit of a chance of being able to fight Empire. But Empire just kind of correct course, get some better pickoffs. And going on top of what you're talking about, that aggression, it felt like Empire knew that whoever had the initiation in this team fight was going to be able to win it. So as long as, even if they're diving into tier fours, it's worth it. As long as they're the ones initiating onto Fnatic.
Right, right. And of course, it's always a beauty to see Empire play Dota as of recent times. Their playstyle is so slapstick. They always want to bring it straight to the opposition's faces and just get right into their territory to the point the enemy actually has to offer a response. Now, I do want to point out one more thing with regards to the draft is that, yeah, you know, Cap, we did call it out in the early stages that Priestess, Sand King, these heroes can certainly scale. And if you look at some of the other cores on Fnatic, such as the Lifestealer, Doom, and Puck, they certainly will bring a lot to the table. The only difference is that because of the pre-6 and how the engagements went on in the early laning phases itself, it appeared so that the Dazzle and as well as the Apparition actually created the difference in terms of the support department, because not only are they better at pre-6, but they just worked in conjunction with the heroes that they were supporting much better. And as stated earlier, of course, No-Tail on the Priestess just couldn't find the opportunities to land really fantastic massive 5-second arrows that guaranteed easy kills for them to get their lanes kind of snowballing. Mm-hmm. So it's a really unfortunate case, because their heroes, like for example No-Tail, just didn't end up with many items to allow him to scale that well, whereas Empire, we could see by the tower count they have as well as the kills on some of their heroes, Meg and Resolution, both sitting at roughly 10-2, 10-3, just ridiculous amount of action that Empire put out, and successfully so. So extremely well done by them. Let's see what they do in game 2.
All right, guys, that's going to be it for game 1. Short little commercial break and everything else, and we will be back with the last game of the night, Fnatic versus Empire, game 2.